over here on the left-hand column. So you have random variables, you have probability distributions over those variables. Those are positive functions. And if I sum over all the values of a variable, I'll get 1. So over on the quantum side, we have something that's very analogous to that. We have density operators. This is just a positive operator on the bounded operators over Hilbert space. And the analog of normalization is trace 1 condition. We also have an analog of a joint probability distribution, which is a bipartite density operator. And we have an analog of marginalization in classical probability theory, which is just a partial trace. But something that's critical to Bayesian inference classically is this notion of conditional probability. The probability of A given B is just the probability of the joint over the probability of B. That's also a positive function. It's defined for values of B such that the probability of those values is positive. And it has the feature that if I sum over A, I get 1 for every value of B. Is there a quantum analog of that? Well, a few years ago, Matt Leifer proposed one, so last year at this conference. You can read about it in this paper. And this is the idea. He actually has various different proposals. There's many ways in which you can find a conditional density operator. This is in some sense the simplest, and furthermore, it's the one that you use when you're discussing inference in the context of measurement theory. So you can't, you can find an inverse of the density operator rho b, the marginal on b. Now, really it's a pseudo-inverse because it could be that rho b has some zero eigenvalues. Fine, so let's take the pseudo-inverse. But now to make the operator symmetric at the end of the day, we just take the square root of the inverse and put it on both sides. And we call it rho sub a given b. So again, it's a positive operator on the bipartite Hilbert space. It's non-zero only on the support of the marginal on b. And it has the analog of this property here. If you trace over a, so imagine taking the trace on the left-hand side, the trace on the right-hand side. Well, that trace moves into the middle, and I just get rho b. And so that cancels with the rho b inverse, and I just get identity on this part of rho b, which is analogous to this equation here. And then once you, let me give you a bit of a feel for what this object is by looking at a simple example of a pure state over two systems. So this is the Schmidt decomposition of that pure state. These are the Schmidt vectors. If I write down the density operator, it has this form. And now I just follow the prescription for calculating the conditional density operator here. And it basically just eliminates those weights. And so the conditional density operator in this case is the projector onto a non-normalized state, psi a given b, which is just exactly the same but without those amplitudes.
So u are normalized?
U and b are normalized, yes. So the moral of the story is that rho ab, in this case, encodes the relation between the Schmidt bases of A and B, whereas the marginal on B is what encodes the actual Schmidt basis for B and the relative amplitudes between the eigenstates of rho B. So the conditional density operator tells you something about relations. Okay, blackboard, the next little slide, and tell you about the motivation. So, in quantum mechanics, we're often interested in calculating correlation functions. So, for example, in condensed matter physics, I might have the ground state for some Hamiltonian. I'm interested in calculating correlation functions for that ground state. Or in a quantum computation, I might be interested in calculating the probabilities of various outcomes on some complicated state. In quantum cryptography, we often want to say, well, if I measure something over here, then what can I infer about what's going on elsewhere? Communication schemes are the same. So those are all examples where we need inference. And in a lot of those examples, we have a large number of systems, especially the computation example and the many body physics example. And the problem is that our description of the density operator for those kinds of systems is exponential in the number of parameters it takes to describe the density operator is exponential in the number of systems. So it becomes infeasible to just do a brute force calculation. And the same problem arises classically. If I have n variables, then the number of parameters and joint probability distribution over those n variables is also exponential in n. So it's a similar kind of problem. And then you can ask, well, classically, how do people deal with this? Well, effectively, most problems have some structure to them, and then the probability distribution is not generic. So to give a simple example, I might have a Markov chain. So the probability distribution over all my value variables might decompose into the probability of A given B, as the probability of B given C, etc. And so now the number of parameters is only linear in the number of systems, and there's a bunch of tools that exist for solving this sort of problem and much more complicated problems. And those tools are things like graphical networks or Bayesian networks, belief propagation algorithms, and the like. And so if you want to have a quantum generalization of those sorts of things, what's really critical in all that business is the notion of a conditional probability. So the conditional density operator that Matt introduced can be put to work trying to generalize those tools, and Matt wrote a paper, a very nice paper with David Poulet, where they do a lot of that, and they look at Markov networks and other things. And it has very practical applications for things like error correction in quantum computation. Now, in this talk, I'm not so interested in the practical applications. I'm interested in more foundational aspects. So one thing that struck me was that these classical schemes basically find it useful to have a graphical representation of these probability distributions. And we now know that from a lot of work in recent years that category theory and the graphical calculus for that provides a nice way of describing quantum processes. So maybe we can describe quantum Bayesian inference and classical Bayesian inference using those same sorts of graphical techniques. So that was a question that motivated this project that Paul and I worked on. And so we basically want to know, can you have a graphical calculus for quantum and classical Bayesian inference? And the answer is yes. I'm going to tell you a bit about it. And now I should emphasize the difference in the interpretation of this calculus to what is usually done is that usually we're thinking about describing a physical process. So time is proceeding forward, so there's some gates happening on systems, for example. Whereas here, the kind of process that I'm going to be describing are things like in classical Bayesian inference, when you divide by the probability of A, well, that's not something that happens out there in the world as a stochastic process. That's something I'm doing as a computation to update my knowledge about something when I learn new information. So here the processes we're modeling are really computations and not physical processes in the world. Okay, so the foundational motivations for this sort of project, well, if we want to really capture what the differences between classical Bayesian inference and quantum Bayesian inference are, then we need a framework in which we can describe both of them. And so this is what this sort of framework can do for us. And hopefully we can perhaps come up with some axioms that might pinpoint the specific features of classical and quantum inference. And if you've got that kind of framework, then you can also start asking questions like, is there a notion of post-quantum Bayesian inference? Are there alternatives even to the quantum Bayesian inference? Ways in which we might have made inferences, but which don't seem to be so effective in our world. And then finally, another thing that has motivated me a lot is that there's some nice work in the classical context on inferring causal structure from correlation structure. So this is in the context of Bayesian networks. And so because causality is such a big issue in quantum theory, it seems to me that if you had analogs of Bayesian networks, of the kind of quantum Bayesian networks that Matt and David have worked on, and if you have other graphical techniques, then maybe you can find some lessons for causality in quantum theory. That's the idea. Okay, so I'm going to start by defining what we call a Bayesian graphical calculus. And fortunately, a lot of the work in defining these categorical concepts has already been done today by others, so I can be pretty brief about it. And I should immediately have a caveat, which is these are early days, and it's not clear to me that we've really captured all the assumptions that ought to go into claiming that something is a Bayesian calculus. Maybe there's some more assumptions to come. Maybe we haven't got enough here yet. All right, so the framework we're working in is dagger symmetric monoidal categories, which we heard about. And these have to have a dagger Frobenius structure, which we've also heard about this morning. So I'll just tell you how we're going to be interpreting these various elements. So the systems about which we're reasoning are going to be represented by the objects in the category, and they'll be associated with a natural number, which in the case of classical Bayesian inference is just the cardinality of the values of the random variable, and in the quantum case is just the dimension of Hilbert space. The states of knowledge, which are what you're manipulating in Bayesian inference, are represented by morphisms, and they're the special morphisms that go from nothingness to your object A. So I'm just going to represent that by a triangle A, so this is a state of knowledge for the object A. And of course, you can have tensor products of systems, so I can have, for example, a product state like that, or I could have some sort of joint state of knowledge, which could be represented by a full triangle. And I'm going to need to process this knowledge as I'm doing my inference, so there are also going to be modifiers. So this, so if I just have a morphism from A to A, think of that as a modifier. So you know, multiplying by the probability over A is an example of that sort of thing. And then finally, the more general sorts of morphisms are inferences. So for example, a morphism from B to A, I'll write as A given B. So this is like a conditional state, which takes an object B, returns an object A. And so this is the kind of thing I'll use to update my knowledge about A given knowledge about B. Okay, so this framework has a compact structure. So we have that special pair of morphisms, the cup and the cap. We have the axioms that tell me yank straight lines into straight lines when I put cup and a cap together. Roughly speaking, the interpretation of these things is going to be, you know, this is a state of perfect correlation. So that's not quite right, but especially in the quantum context. But roughly speaking, that's right, and yeah, you should think about it in that sort of way. So the compact structure allows us to define a transpose operation, and that will be important for the axioms of our calculus. What else? So we have a dagger. John in his talk told us the properties that a dagger has to satisfy. It means I can turn my diagrams upside down. And finally, I have this Frobenius structure. So So now I can tell you what the minimal set of assumptions we found we need are. So the first is that for each object, there should exist a normalized state. So normalization in this context is going to be that if I compose the state with the co-unit, I get the identity morphism from the trivial object to the trivial object, which we denote just by nothing. And you know, similarly, if I have a pair of systems, then they also going to have a normalized state for the pair. And in particular, this means I can define a notion of marginalization. So if I just take the marginal on B, for example, if I just act the co-unit on B, then I know that what I'm left with, so if I compose it with the co-unit, I get the identity map on the trivial object, the analog of the normalization unit, and therefore what I'm left with is also a normalized state, which I can just call A. So this is the analog of that form, those two formulas where I have a sum over A and I get one, or a trace over rho A. Alright, second assumption is that we can associate a modifier with every state. So I'll just write the modifier associated with state A, so it's a morphism from A to A. And it's such that if I acted on the unit, I have to get the state back again. Okay, and you'll note that that's true of those examples. I haven't told you quite what the unit is yet, but you'll see that it's true. And then furthermore, we demand that it's self-transposed. So if I take the transpose of A, I just get the modifier A, I just get A back. Alright, and then the third assumption is that every modifier has an inverse. So I'll just denote that as A inverse. And it should be the case that if I compose a modifier with its inverse, I just get the identity. And similarly, if I do it in the opposite order. We also assume that every state has an inverse relative to the Frobenius multiplication. So if I multiply a state A with its inverse, I should just get the unit. And similarly for the other multiplication. Note that this Frobenius structure is non-commutative. And then finally, I demand that if I act this inverse modifier on the unit, I should just get the inverse state. So that's the structure that we assume. Using it, you can immediately define a notion of a conditional state in this more general setting. So you do that in the obvious way. You have a notion of a joint state. You have a notion of an inverse modifier. So you just act that inverse modifier on the joint state. So I take state AB, take the modifier associated with the inverse state on B, and this will be my definition of state A given B. Like so. And then, just as we did before, you can define a version of Bayes' theorem by using, I can also write down a B given A, where I would hit this with an A inverse. And if I just manipulate those equations, then I find that the conditional A given B is just the conditional B given A. So I'm using the convention that the object on the left now has to be B. So I multiply my, compose with the A modifier, the B inverse modifier, and then I swap them back so that it matches tangent to the left-hand expression. So that's the general form of Bayes' theorem. Okay, and you can write down all sorts of general which is that your modifiers should be written as just the Frobenius multiplication with the state. And furthermore, that the Frobenius multiplication commutes on product states. So this is the feature that gets us classicality. Now, there are other ways of writing it, and you can derive a lot of consequences from that, but I won't bore you with all of that. I'll just instead tell you about some particular representations of this calculus. So it turns out that just standard probability theory is such a representation. And I'll show you what it looks like. So the morphisms are just going to be positive valued matrices. So if you have a morphism from dimension m to dimension n, then it's just an n by m positive valued matrix. The tensor product is just going to be the regular matrix tensor product. Composition is going to be standard matrix product. And then the states are just associated with vectors of positive numbers. So I'll write them as column vectors. So that's my state. I can have joint states on two systems, and that's just going to be a vector over two indices. I have to tell you what the Frobenius structure is. The easiest way to do that is to specify how it acts on a product of states. So I'm going to write A and A prime. It's the same object, but they're different states now. Well, this just corresponds to component-wise products. So if the vector P represents this state, and the vector Q represents this state, and what I get at the end is just the component-wise product of those two states. So I could have written out the n by n squared matrix representing this Frobenius multiplication, but this essentially gives you the idea of what's going on. So if that's our notion of multiplication, then it's clear that the unit has to be just the vector of all ones. Because if I compose, if I put the unit in what happens, I should just get p back again. So the vector of all ones does that for me. And then the co-unit is just going to be the row matrix of all ones. And then the co-multiplication, do people see if I write further down? Okay, we should.
You might even be able to move the screen.
Oh, I can't even reach that high. So.
Isn't there a button?
So I can specify what the co-multiplication is by acting it on the state. And so if this state is associated with the vector p, then this is just associated with the vector pi delta I prime, where I runs from 1 to n. So this just follows by taking the matrix associated with this guy, taking the diagram. And the interpretation is that this is what's sometimes called the classical broadcasting map. It basically says whatever your probability distribution is, generate a distribution over two systems now where they're perfectly correlated, but the marginal for one of them is your original probability distribution. And that's, if I ask, what does that imply for the modifier? Right, so the definition of my C calculus is that the modifier should be a multiplication with the state A. Well, it turns out that's just associated with the matrix, which is diagonal with the components of my state. And it's clear that it doesn't matter whether I multiply it from the left or the right. So indeed, I have the property that it's commutative. If you look at what happens if I act the co-unit on a particular state, the answer is I'm just going to get inner product between the all ones and this guy, and so it's just the sum of the probabilities. And so I can express my normalization condition as And then from these axioms, he gets some mathematics, and he points out that there's some elements of standard probability theory that are purely conventional. And he points out that those are. Now, our axiom system is completely different from his, but we find the same thing, that there are aspects that are completely conventional, and we can do it differently. So in particular, what you can do is assume exactly the same structure. So you know your morphism will be matrices again, but now in place of standard addition and multiplication, you replace it with new notions of addition and multiplication. So if S and T denote scalars, then I can have a new notion of addition defined in terms of any bijective function f. So for any bijective function f, I can define a notion of addition this way, and you can verify that it has all the properties of addition, it's associative, there's a unit for it. And similarly, I can define a new notion of multiplication, which I'll denote this way, in terms of that same bijective function. It's also associative, and they interact properly. You'll find that addition distributes over multiplication and vice versa. And so, for every choice of this function, you get a new representation of this C calculus. And in particular, if you take f of s to be the negative logarithm of s, you work things out, and you find that instead of representing things by vectors of probabilities, you're representing your states of knowledge by vectors of negative logs of probabilities. And then every place where you would normally have a product of probabilities, such as in Bayes' rule, instead you have a sum. So you find, for example, that if you look at a conditional state defined in this way, right, so we have this vector of S components, so I can find a bicarbonate state like that, I can look at the conditional, and if I want to write it in terms of the other conditional, it has this form, which should be familiar to you as the entropic form of the Bayesian formula. Except that in this case, these are not entropy, these are vectors of negative logs of probabilities. But you can basically manipulate this and get entropies out. So the entropic calculus is another special instance of this C calculus. And it's interesting that this is the same sort of conclusion that Cox reached, but with an entirely different axiomatic approach.
Rob?
Yes?
Could you write a bit bigger?
Yes.
It's big word to see.
Sure, thanks. Okay, I'll move on to the quantum version of this now. How much time do I have now? I've done all of it. Okay, so the quantum version is what you'd expect. We define our modifiers to be now a case where you just multiply on the left and the right by the square root of the state. So the square root of the state is defined to be that state which, when I multiply it with itself, gives me state A. So this is the modifier. You can, like the Costco case, you can show that this satisfies those three assumptions, that the three axioms of what a Bayesian calculus is. And then again, you can ask, you know, what representations does it have? And it turns out that Mach's conditional density operator formalism is a representation of this beast, where the Frobenius product is just the operator product, and the unit is just the identity operator, and the co-unit is the trace. And the co-multiplication, and this is interesting, if you find the co-multiplication, you find it's a broadcasting map. And then you say, hang on, we all know that there's no broadcasting in quantum theory, so how can that be? And the answer is, it's a not a completely positive map. It's just a linear map which broadcasts operators. And if I had more time, I would tell you about it. But it's not a problem because, as I said, what we're representing here are not physical processes. There's no need for them to be completely positive. We're representing computations. All right, so conditional, well, features that hold for conditional independence. And what we're finding is that this general framework we have does not satisfy all these axioms, whereas both the quantum and the classical cases do. And therefore, it looks as if there's some opportunities here for maybe understanding ways in which Bayesian inference could be more general. So I'll give you just one example. So one of the axioms is called symmetry. It says, if you already know C, and it's the case that you learn nothing new about A by coming to know B, then if you came to know A, you would learn nothing new about B. So there's a symmetry between A and B. And in this very general framework, that symmetry doesn't hold. So that's one way in which Bayesian inference could be different. There could be an asymmetry in